regards to issues from our guidance. There's no reference to size of bathrooms in there. I think I've noted in other guidances, and indeed in ours, that it talks about sufficient room to hang clothes and to dry and to do other activities within the space, as opposed to just jumping the bathroom and, you know, knocking your head on the front door as you get out of it, sort of thing. I wonder whether we needed to make some efforts. You don't have to reach square meters, it just has to be a genuine judgment about, is there enough room here to, you know, to have clothes and dry clothes, etc. The second point of difference that I've just noted from page 17 and the paper copy was the business of a hand basin in each bedroom. So online it describes the minimum of one hand basin in each bedroom, and the paper copy is a little bit more safe. Honest, talks about just consideration of provision of a hand basin. I understand where you're coming from in terms of how hard it might be for you know, to take an old building and convert it, it might not be. But in a way, that's not really our problem, is it? That's the problem with the developers to get a water supply in each room. So the question comes, we have Eddie's draft that says, or indeed picks up what we discussed at the last meeting, which was an aspiration for a hand basin at least in every room, and then the housing standard, which talks about consideration. Does have a view on hand basins in each room or whether officers will come back on that. Yes, I'll take it. So I think we prefer a hand basin in every room. That's all right. In terms of size, can we get something on size in there, or a guide on size?
This is where Eddie makes a valid point. I've seen, you know, hand basins, tiny hand basins, which would prevent, which would give someone the facility to have a quick swell, but not allow them to wash pots and pans. Yeah. So it's. I mean, we are getting to the minutiae.
The size and type of it must be the development.
Yes.
Well, I thought you were talking about the size of the bathroom.
The bathroom?
Yeah, the whole room. Sorry, I moved on probably without the benefit of a comma. Yeah.
Occupation that have ensuite bathrooms.
that's about distance, is it? So the toilets and the bathroom should be no more than one floor distance away.
Not a specific research. I think we could read something into the policy that says the 6 persons or four.
Don't switch.
It is a problem. just want to make, you know, from an officer's point of view, from a legal point of view, in terms of going forward, we've now given our thoughts about what we want to do or what we'd like to see in our policy documents and where it's going to go. How long will that take to turn around? Just as a quick question.
Depends on the discussions that take place between now and when we get the agreed finalised version, which then officially needs to also over the subcommittee, because it's our terms of reference. This subcommittee's terms of reference say that the development in consultation with the appropriate overview of scrutiny committee. So we need to find a way, a mechanism for that to happen. And then it would go forward to Cabinet. Of course, then we also have to then build in a consult and an external consultation period. The best thing I can say is that we will move this forward as expeditiously as we can.
Thanks. If we're going to consult with the scrutiny committee, if we're going to do that with the committee by email, I'm sure we can do it with members of the scrutiny committee by email.
Energy efficiency and carbon neutral housing and So it may very well be that that's it, to another section of our policies entirely. But really, it's key, isn't it, to anybody who wants to build a house anywhere in the world is going to go to our housing policies first. And it probably needs to be, or does it need to be on the face of our housing policy that we're expecting as carbon neutral housing developments as we possibly can? We don't want, we want new developments to be built in such a way that they don't have to be retrofitted for micro generation, etc. Is that something that we ought to have a specific housing policy about, as opposed to it sitting almost as an afterthought, as, you know, here we are with environmental policies? Yeah? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Okay, thanks, Chair. We do have another policy that we intend to bring to this committee at the next meeting in November. It's a policy for sustainable design. The intention is that policy would apply to all development, not just houses. And inside the housing policy, there will be a link to that. So at the end of the current chapter, it says meet the requirements of policy CS1A. We do need to sort of longer account, but there is a policy that would apply to all developments, industrial developments, retail developments, housing developments, so that we catch it for a lot. And the current thoughts are to utilise BREEAM standards and what the latest best practices. That will come before the committee in November. The thing that I emphasise for your consideration tonight is that there will be a direct link to that policy, so that rather than repeat it in every single section,
specific guidelines for different types of build, whether it's sort of a large sort of build by the likes of Peel perhaps, compared to a smaller build, so that they are all sort of perhaps carbon neutral by their own. How will be determined?
Well, at the moment, the policy is written as a catch-all, regardless of its size. I'm willing to take advice on that. How we deal, if we want to deal with larger scale, or is it just, you know, the standard will apply regardless of its size. In terms of the Peel, there's already a planning permission in place with conditions that catches that kind of thing. As I said, we in the district covered inside of those policies. There will be separate area policies that will cover, one of those will cover Wirral waters, and that's another policy that will be put to the committee as we go on.
Thank you.
I think if we have one policy as a cat eye catches everything, I think I would say, as we read through all of these, it does refer to other policies. You quite remember, it doesn't tell us what it covers. So, for example, it's got to comply with policy CS21. I mean, you're then going to start. I mean, maybe you will know off the top of your head what policy CS21 is, but maybe in brackets, if we can have broadly, the title of the policy, then at least we know. We know the area that it's also got to comply with. Okay, Steve.
On that point, I think it'd be useful if we had a dictionary or an ongoing index which lists them all on one page so that you can quickly see what they're referenced to and quickly find them.
That's the intention as well. Once we know where we're going with these and we're able to put semblance in terms of an overview, we will have a structure at the beginning of the study. But also going to have a table that considers the impacts of the policy as well. That's a way.
Okay, so if we can work through appendix, or generating four in fact, appendix, whatever one. Start with the housing requirement, that's clearly a strategic policy, and we've already discussed the housing need assessment, which is ongoing, which is why it's for vexes and the like. Are we okay with that?
Yeah.
We then have the criteria for residential developments. I raise a point on this on paragraph number 5, where it says that we're expected to comply with the nationally prescribed technical space standards. Are we going to put web links to send us to what they are, or are we going to say what they are?
National housing standard is produced by the government. The reason we haven't followed the tack that we do with the HMOs in this is that has liable to change at any time. And when you need the documents, it was produced in 2015, and then it was updated again in 2016. So there is the prospect there for change. The way national guidance is put to us is that for policy purposes, all we have to do is make reference to that. There's no problem in putting the link into it. There's no problem in putting the link into it. It's just that the link may change.
We would decide that, you know, the 20-year extension, therefore the some of the issues about requiring a new school to be built wouldn't necessarily weigh very highly in the balance when we're considering what weight to give the policy against the application we have for just. We have a state of sort of 4,000 houses that we will give significant weight to the fact that we probably want a school alongside us. Does that make sense for you?
Yeah. So sort of, I just wonder why we said we include extensions in the first place because
I think this is a strategic policy as well. Yeah. This is like we go into extensions a little bit further down to specific, but this is like your umbrella one as well. As like a more strategic policy. So our expectation is. A little bit more detail later. Yeah. But perhaps I could be made a bit clearer as to what is where things sit. Maybe coming back to the point that Steve made about the list of the policies and where they sit under one of them to that extent. Just for our own benefits if not on my experts. Okay. Yes, Jeff.
Interesting talk about strategic. I mean, I was looking at this in terms of HS4, which is a policy which comes up every planning committee meeting, basically, doesn't it? It's the one we all wrestle with, argue about, and then it's going to get a satisfactory result from. So I'm reading this and I'm thinking, how much has this changed for HS4? And it all sounds all very good. I was a bit thrown by the fact, including extensions, conversions, and changes of use. I'm sure was that in HS4 before, wasn't that just specifically new housing before, I think. Yeah. But I mean, I come down to item 3, and this is the one which really is as a committee. Maintain a minimum separation with adjacent properties of 21 metres or 14 metres. And those are those two measurements which we're always arguing over. And then you get to the next column, which is plus 4 metres for each addition of the floor. And wasn't that plus 50%?
I'm not sure on that thing. I'm living in that standard that we occupy our current gardens for flats.
I have this idea that if, I had in my mind that if it was 21 metres and that was a different floor, it went to 31.5. And the 2 metres for each additional roof ridge, I think that's certainly more than that. People get very upset about the fact that this building is going to be put up against their back fence and it's going to be like that against the sky. But because their own back garden is more than 21 metres long, tough, you know. That is the one which I've sat at that table in planning committee many, many a time. And that is absolutely appropriate in a post-war development of semi-detached houses. But then you take it to my ward, you put it in the Corley Conservation Area, talking about mansions which are supposed to be set no more than 2 to the acre. I mean, this is ridiculous. We must have some other way of doing this.
Okay, there's two books I'll address the conservation area first. We will reach the conservation area ones, which will set different standards to this. So in fact, it will override in the common conservation area. Standard in the conservation area will override that. Am I right in saying that? It's not sounding like previous councils. But that's why I'm standing on that. The second point you made is the first point was I didn't say about the 50% thing. I think we can maybe check that rather than guess. I think what we'll do with the minutes. I mean, the difference between these policies now is we're not required to agree with them and move them on because we're not trying to give it a high status. What we're trying to do is get the draft right so that when it goes into the consultation in next year, then we've broadly got what we think we need. And then obviously we'll take account of other representations that we receive from, of course, probably better take that. next agenda, maybe if we have some action points, otherwise in amendments. So Eddie said he's going to check the business about the distance for each additional stone. So if that, that can be reflected in the minutes as a maybe a post-meeting note, and if you need to go back to it in terms of debate, we'll pick it up in the minutes. So we like a more action minutes than anything else. Is that all okay?
But yeah, I should have said conservation there, because really what the things which are in the public's mind is these are actually things that were originally maintained by covenants, and of course covenants aren't planning issues, but the general layout of the area assumes big spaces, and yet the planning guideline could allow something ridiculously small, which certainly needs addressing.
Very often when we've attempted to refuse things by residents, we refer to character of an area. Is it, that's possibly the point that's being made, that if we're going to have like a development in an area where the character of it doesn't necessarily mean yes, it meets these things, but nevertheless, the character of an area which may not be a conservation area, because we seem to protect that in a different way. But I can't see character mentioned in this policy. It's okay.
Well, yeah,
I think, Chair, if you go to the top of the next page, second line, and be compatible with the character of the area. But I'm just concerned that that is a sort of a subjective thing.
Well, it is.
You know, could be defended, yeah. That's the problem.
Well, character is always got to be subjective.
Again, if obviously the existing policy doesn't have the standard, but it's the 21 metre rule, 14 metre rule, has been the general thing for new houses. The idea was to try and give some certainty to what the minimum rules and it's taken into account with the rule policy that we're going to bring in, that we're saying applies to everything. That is it. It's going to have to be considered in the context of its surroundings. So, you know, take not toll and bridge.
And then you're going to have another view just for those of you.
Yeah, take not toll and bridge. Take Tramia, the totally different set of character. Things that would be judged on the merits rather than terms of this policy and the main policy that will apply along to one of them.
Which is the main policy?
At the moment it's called the sustainable design.
Okay, so I think so long as you know it's somewhere. That's important. So we had the brief discussion about carbon neutrality. I'm you know, keen that our houses achieve that, don't have to be retrofitted for. I've received assurance that it's somewhere. Council will raise the question of character. I'm now being assured that it's somewhere in a more strategic policy. Are we content?
Just mention, I'm just a little worried about, say, 21 is the minimum, because I can think of being the planning committee where it's only 20, and you know, that's all right then, you know. I thought, if it's minimum, it's minimum.
Come on, let's get stoned on my own last of the last.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Criteria for residential. Affordable housing requirement. I think I've noted that the way we go about this is slightly different. We used to have in a core 10%
defence faults have become more questionable when you move back to zone one. And in zone one, the readings are showing that nothing's viable. But we're going to need to take some decisions on and then whether the affordable housing should not be sorted in zone one. So the evidence coming out of this and the SHMA has not been finalised over XXX percent. That's the current thinking.
Okay. Any questions on that?
So when will we see the evidence is coming out, or will we be able to discuss it in the room and have a look at this?
As I said, the viability report is scheduled to be reported to the cabinet in November. So there are final checks to be done on the report. My colleagues are working away at that as we speak. Be able to see it when it goes on the agenda. And we could bring it to this committee. The committee wanted us to come back at a later date to revisit this.
Just in terms of zone one, he's saying that Birkenhead is zone one and zone two is Wallasey. And he's saying that the criteria has more than times he wouldn't be put on the floor at all. This is zone one. So where do you get appeal, for example? They're in zone one.
Yes.
And the criteria from the local planning position got to be built on the field sites. And requirements, and Stuart's just done it now, but we just pushed through the Buffer Road site, 178 new houses for affordable housing, and they're to go sell it. So I don't see where, I can't understand that. So.
Yeah, the point is, I'm not suggesting that we would tear down affordable housing and want to do. I'm merely just reporting on what the findings are, and that we'll have to take some decisions about how we play that, and that's going to have to be alongside this strategic housing market assessment that was talking about for the HMO policy, and we've not seen that come out into the wash yet. So the XXX is there because you need to take decisions about that. And decisions will be taken by cabinet and forward to council for approval on that.
Yeah. Just to follow up on that one, yeah, I think it's vitally, vitally important whether it's here sitting down in the subcommittee or sitting down anywhere in council. At the end of the day, you've got a local plan to ensure we've got sent through, and if we haven't got the evidence and the base evidence to be able to see that and do it, how are we supposed to make any recommendation to it?
Well, I don't think we are on this. I think we're going to understand this. It's fair. So, and then when the evidence is produced and the cabinet agrees it as an evidence base, then the officers will put some percentage numbers into there, I guess, and we can either. Evidence is evidence, but I guess we'll be visiting at that point. Can I take him, Jim?
Thank you, Chair. I think overriding for this local plan is the regeneration of Birkenhead, because it is a failed market. And I fail to see how skewing it to affordable housing in Westbrook is going to help Birkenhead, especially when the criteria states that the affordable housing should be on site. To do 40% affordable housing is going to mean that every other house is going to be next door to an affordable house. So the people that want to spend £300,000 on their nice shiny new four-bed detached in whatever, that value will be diminished because they won't really want to be on a station.